The question, when the individual who is questioning the power stops to be a hero and becomes a nut, you know, or vice versa, or together. You know, I have seen at the end of the war, I have seen people going with a broom against the tank. Well, people are screaming, he's a nut. 2 weeks later, they, you know, built the statues and called him a hero.
C'était une fois en 1975, Vol au-dessus d'un nid de coucou, le second film que Miloš Forman réalise aux États-Unis, adapté du roman de Ken Kesey. Pour échapper à la prison, Randall McMurphy, un petit malfrat soupçonné de viol, interprété par Jack Nicholson, se fait passer pour fou et interné dans un hôpital psychiatrique. Il se lie aux autres malades qui subissent comme lui la discipline de fer qu'impose l'infirmière en chef, Nurse Ratched, incarné par Louise Fletcher. Peu à peu, il se dresse contre un règlement absurde et carcéral et entraîne ses compagnons dans sa rébellion. Puni une première fois par une séance d'électrochoc, il est révolté par le suicide d'un jeune patient et il sera lobotomisé après avoir tenté d'étrangler l'infirmière. Son ami l'Indien Big Chief, joué par Will Sampson, met fin à ses souffrances et s'évade.
My father acquired the novel in what we call galley form before the book is published, and he had the book translated into a play. He came to Broadway, which was very unusual for a superstar. He was right after Spartacus and at the top of his form as a film actor, and the idea being that, you know, after the play they would then translate it into a movie.
And he couldn't get one studio to finance the film. Because they were all saying, well, that, you know, is too depressing. Who wants to see mentally ill people? And then he went to Czechoslovakia, Kirk Douglas. He saw one of my films. He obviously liked it. And he realized that maybe if somebody like this guy, who can make film on peanuts, black and white, cheap, quickly, very fast, I can finance it myself. So he asked me there if he can send me the book, and if I read it and tell him if I would be interested to make a movie. My God, tomorrow I would do that, of course. But the censors at the communist border confiscated the book and didn't tell him and didn't tell me.
Miloš Forman est né en Tchécoslovaquie en 1932 et ses parents seront assassinés par les nazis. Il réalise son premier long métrage, L'As de pique, en 1963. Ses films suivants, Les amours d'une blonde et Au feu les pompiers, ont fait de lui le chef de file de la nouvelle vague du cinéma tchèque et la bête noire de la bureaucratie communiste. Invité en 1968 au Festival de Cannes, il se trouve à Paris lorsque les chars soviétiques mettent fin au printemps de Prague. En 71, il tourne aux États-Unis Taking Off, la fugue d'une adolescente américaine avec un jeune musicien, son premier des trois films qu'il consacrera au mouvement hippie.
Seven years later, my father, who had been trying to get the movie made and could not, was going to sell the property. And I said, let me try to get this project going. I love this script. Let me try to get you to play the part of R.P. McMurphy. And he agreed. And I saw that at one time, Saul Zance and Fantasy Records had inquired about the project and expressed some interest. So I contacted Saul back again. He said, yes, I'm still interested. And then I saw Fireman's Ball. So we were interested in Milos.
The irony is that the same book is sent to me by two producers, Saul Zance and Michael Douglas, the son of Kirk Douglas, who didn't know that his father was already sending me the book 7 or 8 years ago.
Avant d'être un film, Vol au-dessus d'un nid de coucou est le premier roman de Ken Kesey, publié en 62. Originaire de l'Oregon, ce fils de paysan a fait une école de journalisme avant de poursuivre des études de littérature à San Francisco, où est en train de naître le mouvement hippie.
Et en tant qu'étudiant, il a besoin de gagner sa vie. Et donc, il est la nuit, il est aide de nuit dans un hôpital psychiatrique qui s'appelle Menlo Park Veterans Hospital. Et pour arrondir encore plus, il s'aperçoit qu'on demande des cobayes pour des expériences très particulières dans ce même hôpital. C'est un programme de tests et de produits chimiques hallucinogènes. À l'époque, personne ne connaissait ces choses-là. La CIA les connaissait, c'était un programme caché, illégal d'ailleurs, qui s'appelait MK Ultra, qui consistait à faire sur des volontaires payés $75 par jour, ce qui est pas mal pour l'époque, des expériences avec du LSD, des amphétamines. Et donc, Ken Kesey teste toutes sortes de drogues. Et puis la nuit, il est aide-malade dans cet hôpital psychiatrique. Et c'est dans des états qu'on devine qu'il visite les malades et qu'il voit les soins comme ça. Qu'on leur procure à base d'électrochocs, de douches glacées, de camisoles de force. C'est à l'ancienne. Et lui, il voit ça, il se dit « mais on ne peut pas traiter des gens comme ça ». Et c'est de là que vient évidemment le livre « Vol au-dessus d'un lit de coucou ». L'idée, c'est que ces gens ne sont pas malades, et en admettant même qu'ils le soient et qu'il faille les soigner, la psychiatrie classique ne fait que soigner les symptômes, mais pas la cause, puisque la cause est extérieure à l'individu, la cause est sociale. Kesey nous dit en gros, pour soigner les fous, il faut faire la révolution.
Durant les années 60, la jeunesse californienne se rebelle. Musique, drogue, libération des mœurs, pacifisme, cette contestation se répand dans le monde. Ken Kesey se fait le chantre des acides tests et autres expériences hallucinogènes. Il parcourt les États-Unis à bord d'un bus, avec la troupe des Merry Pranksters, tandis que son roman devient le best-seller de toute une génération. C'est à lui que Saul Zenz et Michael Douglas commandent la première version du scénario, mais ils ne trouveront aucun terrain d'entente, ni financier, ni artistique.
You know, the book is written from the point of view of a schizophrenic Indian. And it was... which is beautiful for literature. So exaggerated everything, you know, it's the big nurse, you know, the vapor coming out of her nostrils, you know, and the wires sticking out of her hair. And when she touches the wall, the blood comes out and things like that, which is wonderful to read in a literature, but to see it on the screen in a real photography, you know, it would be ridiculous, you know.
If Mr. McMurphy doesn't want to take his medication orally, I'm sure we can arrange that he can have it some other way. But I don't think you'd like it, Mr. McMurphy.
You'd like it, wouldn't you?
Well, give it to me.
Good.
Miloš very much wanted to direct on practical locations. It was his experience in Czechoslovakia. It was how he felt most comfortable. So the producers, Saul Zenz and Michael Douglas, made a tour of mental institutions in America.
The novel was not very popular in the mental health, mental hospital area. What with electroshock treatment and how patients were treated, so there were not many hospitals who wanted to help us.
Except Dr. Dean Brooks in Salem, Oregon. Because he said, well, yeah, I will let you shoot here if I will use it as a therapy for my patients.
I thought, well, why not? This would be great to have Hollywood come to the state hospital right here in Salem. Also, I said, if I am the technical advisor, I could have some say-so on whether or not we denigrate the patients, which I did not want to happen. I got the first copy of the script, and my heart sank. The words, particularly for the professionals to say, didn't make any sense to me. And I called Saul Zantz, and I explained it to him. And he said, Dean, what you do, you sit down and write in what you think ought to be said. And I very laboriously did.
And it was actually Dr. Brooks, not the producers of the film, who explained to me what the deal was between the hospital and the production company. He had bargained for inclusion of the patients in as many areas of the filmmaking process as was possible. The only thing he did not want was for the patients to be patients.
We have people who've been hospitalized as long as 24 years.
Dean Brooks est un psychiatre progressiste. Pour trouver des alternatives au traitement classique, il emmène par exemple ses patients en randonnée dans les montagnes de l'Oregon. Lorsqu'il accepte le tournage du film, électrochoc et lobotomie ne sont plus utilisés à des fins punitives dans son hôpital. Aujourd'hui, dans la plupart des pays, la lobotomie est interdite et les électrochocs sont réservés à des pathologies très spécifiques.
Was particularly concerned over the way they were going to do the shock therapy scene. But then I came to realize that this was a movie that was being made and was not a documentary about Oregon State Hospital or any mental hospital, and that the important thing then is the story. When I came around to that point of view, then I relaxed and began to sleep again.
Casting was interesting. Jack Nicholson was always my first choice, but we learned when we were ready to shoot, we learned that we have to wait 6 months because he had a contract to make another film, you know?
Jack, you know, he won the Academy Award. He looks like he was a natural for that part. But truth is, before this movie, he had played like the sensitive young men. He'd done, you know, five easy pieces, easy rider, kind of a sensitive young man part.
The producers told me, listen, is there anybody else whom you would like to have as a McMurphy? I said, the only one would be Marlon Brando. Thanks God, he even refused to read the script.
Jack is one of those actors who makes it look very easy. But we rented houses right next to each other during the movie. And I know the hours that he rehearsed at home and the hours that he spent to make it all look so easy.
From the moment he comes on the set till the moment he leaves the set, he is the most prepared, disciplined, generous, actor, absolutely perfect. But before he comes on the set, and after he leaves the set, I don't know till today if he's crazy or not. I don't know till today. Big Nurse, that was even more interesting, because I thought, yeah, she's an evil. She's real evil. But here, you have this angelic person whom you trust. I think she even believes that she's doing good, that she's helping. She's so sweet. That's the most dangerous evil. That really makes you, you know, shiver.
I mean, this is not a decision that was made by me. This was a decision that was made by Saul and Michael and Milos, that they would play her as a human being, not as a symbol of a system.
We had five actresses, five stars, who turned the part down. Because in the 1970s, and the women's liberation movement, you know, it was not chic to play a villain, you know? You want to be the hero.
My biggest insecurity was, would I be natural and real as a human being in this role? And could I be powerful enough against Jack Nicholson, whose personality and persona is so powerful?
But one day I get a call from Milos Forman. Then, this Milos, we let you come up and have you read for us. What he meant was that Jack and Nicholson and he would come to Salem and I was to read for the part.
We all liked him. He had this great kind of crazy look with these big bushy eyebrows, and he had this kind of hawk nose. It was a great-looking character.
Another 2 months go by, and I get a call. Dean, you're quite a bit awkward, he says, but we want you to play the part.
In the end, I wanted him to be as is described in the book. Big, tall as a tree trunk, right? That's not easy to find, because Indians generally are small, you know, people. So we sent scouts to Canada.
6 months later, I'm in my office, my phone rings. Hello, Michael says, yeah, this is Mel Lyman, Mel Lyman Motors. And he says, yeah, Michael, biggest son of a bitch Indian walked in the other day. This boy, I think he's just what you're looking for.
Well, then we want to see him. So they flew him to Portland. And I asked Jack Nicholson to fly with us because can he act?
We were going to meet him at the airport in Portland, Oregon, and have a meeting at the airport and an interview.
And now the door opened, and here comes Will Sampson. Oh, well, great!
That's him. That's him. And I remember Jack, and I can't believe it, that's him. Now we just got to find out if he can talk. Wait a minute, he doesn't have to talk.
But he was like a God's man in the end. He was a very intelligent guy, very good painter. You know, his drawings are in Smithsonian Institute in Washington.
All artists, yes, actor, no. I am first, last, and always a painter. Okay?
Quiet now. Action. Get down there. Get down, chief. Down the gun. Ready?
The plan was to bring the actors up early. They had about 2 weeks of rehearsal time, and during that period of time, the actors were basically given tours of the hospital, invited to sit in on patient therapy meetings, visit the wards, just basically hang out with the patients and get some sense of what their surroundings would be like, you know, the kinds of characters they would be playing. Their crew didn't have as much advanced prep up there as the actors did, but they also were taken around.
Hey, camera!
Hey, camera! You ready?
We're rolling!
And I gave every actor one particular patient to observe. Observe this person, how that person walks, talks, behaves, moves, and do that.
I remember the doctor saying, it's a little difficult to tell the patients from the actors. You know, they both, where is the sanity, you know? It was great because he got a real feel of the hospital. The ward that we stayed in, where we shot the entire film, the hospital, it had its sleeping area, had the nurse's station, it had a game room, the shower room.
During that week, of preparation. I sat in on a group therapy session that was very interesting and helped me very much with the scenes that we did of group therapy. And Jack Nicholson and I witnessed electroshock therapy. I don't know why they thought it was important for me. I guess they wanted me to see what it was that I was responsible for.
How many of our hospital patients were involved in the movie? Do you have any idea?
A total, yes, because I employed all of them. I know exactly how many.
How many did you have?
We had 85 patients.
85?
85 who worked. 55 who worked in front of the camera as extras, and the rest who worked off and on behind the scenes.
They helped the electricians and the gaffers, and they helped the caterers, and helped in the beautician's office, and all over.
I worked with electricians. Mainly I just moved stuff and helped set it up. But I was scared to death because I thought, here's these movie stars, and all I am is just a little patient.
I feel treated as an equal, though, not like, you know, somebody that was just thrown into him.
And I remember very well that there was this guy, when we started shooting, he was unable to put three words together so that they make sense. When we finished shooting, he was giving orders, he was giving speeches, it really worked for Dr. Dean Brooks, you know.
At the beginning, I objected to it because in a mental hospital for psychiatrists or physicians, we didn't want to take the time away from patient care. That was my main objection. I thought filming a movie like this in the campus would be like a circus. Luckily, I had a good relationship with him. I could tell him this thing, Dr. Brooks. But later on, I was offered a small role as a doctor in the movie.
Well, I still think he's quite sick.
You think he's dangerous?
Absolutely so.
What we did not know and did not realize is that most of the patients that were working with us from the hospital in the movie were criminally insane.
For instance, the a young man who was the most famous arsonist in the state of Oregon, which is why he was there, gravitated to the electrical department. And they gave him the job of wiping down the arcs for the 10K lamps with a 5-gallon can of kerosene. Of course, we had no idea. By the same token, we had a number of people who were there for sexual crimes of one kind or another, some severe, some less severe. They seemed to gravitate toward the work crews that mopped the floors outside the actresses' dressing rooms.
This was the the early 70s, and it was rock and roll. So we were having a good time, but it was wonderful to watch these patients, you know, just becomes such a close part of the company.
There was an underground railway under the hospital. And in those underground corridors where patients who had died were unclaimed by family, their ashes were put in coffee cans. And there were stacks of coffee cans. And there were also bins of leftover eyeglass frames, pipes, pencils, pads, things that patients had left behind.
Many, many objects, little ones, bigger ones, little personal things, you know, chewed up pencils and, I don't know, you know, wallets and, oh, just all kinds of objects. And they said to all these actors, choose what you want, and that will be yours for the whole movie. So it was such a gift I know I had a record book that I carried around with me all the time.
And slowly a feeling of that ward being home really grew. Like, I have my own bed on the ward. And it feels more like my own bed than the one at the hotel.
It turned out to be an incredible experience. And it got to the point where some of the actors actually slept at night in their beds on the set. And finally, when Jack Nicholson came, we had 2 weeks of rehearsal, and Jack couldn't make the first week. And he's looking around, and he's looking, and I go, Jack, are you all right? Are you okay? He says, who are these people? Who are these people? They don't even stop at lunchtime. At lunchtime, they don't even stop. And it's true, they all were into their characters, and they never stopped.
We improvised a lot. We decided not to stick to script slavishly. In fact, sometimes we didn't stick to script at all. There was always a point to each scene. But Nicholson is a very free actor, a very loose actor. Forman is a director who is, I think, more interested in accidents than in anything else, in capturing accidents on film.
When an actor would start doing something, getting into the groove, really getting into something, and Milos would just let the camera run, you know? And there might be just for one little moment out of that improvisation that could be used.
We never rehearsed my scene with Jack, the opening scene. Milos gave us 6 points to cover. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Don't care how you get there, just do it. So I asked Jack, I said, well, what am I gonna do? He said, well, watch my eyes. He said, see my eyes? Never let your eyes wander in front of camera. If you want to look someplace, turn the head and look. Don't let the eye shift. We did this, Jack and I, in 2 takes. It worked well, and I had fun.
That set was vibrating. It was so alive with creativity from so many people. It, you know, it could give you a frisson, you know. It could give you goosebumps just from being there and watching it.
Rolling.
The amount of improvisation was, to me, unexpected. And that created physical problems, not just for me, but for everybody on the crew. It wasn't always clear where the microphone should be. It wasn't always clear where the camera should be pointed. We had old, heavy cameras trying to keep track of actors who were improvising on a regular basis, led by Jack Nicholson, who never, in my recollection, never did a scene or a take the same way twice.
My experience has all been mostly in real locations. Being the director of photography, I had to figure out ways to do it to give them as much freedom of movement because there are a lot of characters playing a lot of times, and it was an institution. So, and then to keep it interesting because institutional lighting doesn't lead itself to any drama.
Haskell's plan for lighting the film or painting with light under the difficult circumstances that were created by the outside light levels, the fluorescence, the limitations of equipment, was at odds with Milos's.
I know more about shooting than Milos. Now, Milos may say something different, but I'll tell you, I know a lot about more shooting than Milos, and particularly the Milos of that time.
Haskell was senior in age and experience to Milos. Milos was very new at that time to, let's say, American filmmaking, and we did a lot of things, maybe in some cases without Milos's knowledge, to keep him in his comfort zone.
For a perfectionist cameraman, the ideal film is without actors, because nothing moves, nothing disturbs the light. You can light everything and it always stays the same way, right? For director, the ideal film is without camera, because camera always intimidates actors a little bit. So it would be ideal not to have the camera at all. So, you know, if you have perfectionist director and perfectionist cameraman, it clashes very often, yeah.
To this day, that was the most difficult thing that I ever had to do as a producer, was to tell an Academy Award winning Haskell Wexler that he was off the movie. That was the most difficult thing I've ever had to do. I had great, great respect for him. But as I explained, Haskell, it's you or the director.
When I told my American friends, listen, they offered me to make one for a Cuckoo's Nest, they said, don't touch it. Don't touch it. It will hurt you because it's impossible. It's such an Americana. It's such an American subject. And you, fresh immigrant from Czechoslovakia, there is no way you can do it so that, you know, Americans can like it. And I am looking at them and saying, what are you talking about? For you, it's a book, it's a literature. But for me, it's a real life. I lived in that society. Communist Party was my big nurse, telling me what to do, what not to do, what to say, what not to say, what to think, what not to think, you know, when to go to bed, when to get up. You know what this is about, much better than you do.
The subject of that movie, it was particularly close to me as I was involved in campaigning against the use of psychiatry for repressive purposes. And I could immediately understand what Forman did.
Enfermé lui-même 12 ans au total dans une institution psychiatrique, le dissident Vladimir Bukovsky a réussi en 71 à faire passer à l'Ouest un document intitulé Une nouvelle maladie mentale en URSS, l'opposition. Il sera expulsé de son pays en 76. L'enfermement psychiatrique des opposants en Union soviétique sera systématisé après les accords d'Helsinki qui interdisent les prisonniers politiques et qui sont signés par l'URSS en 75, l'année du tournage de Vol au-dessus d'un nid de coucou.
It all started in 1959-1960 under Khrushchev, and Khrushchev, I think, traveling abroad, answering a question from the audience about how many political prisoners still remain in the Soviet Union. He answered, none, we don't have any political prisoners. By and large, people are pleased with the political system we have, and few who are not pleased are mentally ill.
For them, it was very easy, you know, to use psychiatry to, you know, persecute people, because it's not political. Psychiatry is not political. Oh, this man is mentally ill, you know, we are just treating him, we are helping, they were helping him.
Whatever you do is regarded as a manifestation of your illness, automatically. So if orderlies complain that you became violent, you are punished. You get the extra treatment with some neuroleptics, some painful drugs and things like that. There is no way you can prove anything in this place. They don't listen to you.
Murphy didn't toe the line, so they severed his brain. You know, it's like, so I feel those feelings were very, very intense during the 60s and 70s, I guess, and that people really related to it. You know, being compelled to go to Vietnam because the government wanted you to go there, and being asked to sacrifice your life for something that nobody believed in. You know, and I feel that's what McMurphy stood up for it, you know.
And that's the beauty of the movie, because it gives you the most important part of this dilemma, how to behave, what is your attitude to these things, how much you go along with it, and should you go along with it, should you rebel, and if you rebel, how much support you can hope for.
I realized today what an incredible film this is. And I realized it when Bromden was killing McMurphy. And I was in bed, and I was asleep. And suddenly I'm being shaken. And I'm being shaken by the director who says, "Don't move." And somebody told me that just at the point when Bromden was strangling McMurphy, I jumped. So, the way I figure it, that must be a pretty heavy scene, because I was asleep, and the vibes came in.
Chief Bromden, to me in the movie, represented man's spirit, the strength, ability to endure the most terrible hardship and survive. And he flies out that window. To me, it's like the survivors of the Holocaust or of any regime that is holding them hostage.
It's late in the day, it's about 5 o'clock, and this is the last day of our shooting here. There are bars on the window, though. And we've all the actors in the film, have spent, well, as I said, close to 3 months in this area. So it's the last day, so some people are sad. But I think it's probably going to be a good movie. I hope so. I see you.
Vol au-dessus d'un nid de coucou sort en salle aux États-Unis le 19 novembre 75. Le premier montage d'une durée de 4h30 a été ramené à 2h13 par Miloš Forman et ses trois équipes de monteurs. Sans l'aide d'aucun studio et sans distributeur jusqu'à la dernière minute, le film connaît un succès inattendu et mondial.
The commercial success of the movie was not anticipated, I'm sure. And the dedication of the people making the movie, and that includes the actors and Milos and Jack and everybody and myself, was very good, very strong, and very sure you're sort of referred to some inside conflicts, but the basic thing was we all wanted to make that movie.
I went to Chicago for a screening in a regular theater, and it was a big theater and it was full of people. And when McMurphy has Nurse Ratched by the throat, people are screaming and standing. And when the movie was over and they stood up and they applauded and applauded and applauded and applauded, and I was just very impressed and moved, excited. I never experienced that before in my life.
We premiered in Hollywood and San Francisco and Washington. They also did that right here in Salem with the cast present for the patients and staff of Oregon State Hospital, just the staff and patients. And the patients roared, they loved them. Loved the movie.
They laughed and they had a good time and they felt like being liberated from themselves.
Only negative thing came from the American Psychiatric Association. Those are the guys objected to it mostly because they thought it would put mental illness or treatment in bad light.
Pour contrer cette mauvaise publicité, une agence gouvernementale commande en 77 un documentaire à une partie de l'équipe qui a travaillé avec Miloš Forman. Le principe en est simple, pour chaque scène thérapeutique tournée par Forman à l'hôpital de Salem, une contre-scène sera filmée dans le même hôpital avec les vrais malades et les vrais docteurs, mais le résultat n'aura pas l'effet escompté.
Of course, the reality is much more threatening and staggering to people. So it was a miscalculation, and it made the documentary even more controversial in its own way than the film had been. And it certainly didn't accomplish the goal of convincing a large population in this country that this is all right. If this has to happen to you, you'll be fine.
Cette controverse n'altère pas le succès du film. Pour les Oscars de 76, Vol au-dessus d'un nid de coucou apportant de sérieux concurrents. Les Dents de la mer de Spielberg, Amarcord de Fellini ou encore Barry Lyndon de Kubrick. Bien que le film de Forman soit favori avec 9 nominations, la soirée commence mal.
The first four we lost. And then it came to screenplay. We won. It came to director. And Milos was there with his two his twins. Sons and director, we won.
Have they seen your picture yet?
Well, when they arrived, I asked them if they want to see my film, and they said, well, we would rather see Jaws.
We got the best actress, and Louise and we won.
Louise, Fletcher.
It's very heavy, but I'm not going to let go.
And then Jack was—he was sitting right in front of me. He was, yeah, you know, and then he won. So it was a very special night.
Right here. Thank you.
I think most actors want to win an Oscar if they can. You know, I'm still getting used to working regular. You know, I don't take it that seriously. I know a lot of people do, and I take them seriously, but I'm not an entertainer, I'm an actor, and we don't have too many events where we can go out and just have a good time.
That was the second film only which got all 5 main Oscars. The best film, best director, best actor, best actress, best screenplay. The other one was, it happened one night. Frank Capra in 1936. And after we got these 5 Oscars, you know, I got a telegram from Frank Capra. Welcome to the club.
In Florida, before the movie, if you showed strange behavior, you did not have to commit a crime. If you showed strange behavior, you could be arrested and put in jail. And after the movie, they eliminated that law that you could not arrest somebody just because his behavior was strange. So I would hope and like to think that it opened a lot of people's eyes about mental health.
The story of a hero, like the story of Christ, who gives his life for his people, is a universal story, a powerful story that spoke to millions and millions and millions of people, not just about mental health, you know, about power and the misuse of power.
The phrase Jack Nicholson says, which was really very much the phrase we would use to say in our time, at least I tried, damn you, he says. And that's exactly what we all thought. We tried and tried, and finally we succeeded. Look, Soviet Union doesn't exist, and we're still alive.
We must live together and create institutions. We must create institutions, governments, schools, hospitals, whatever, you know, to help us, to serve us, you know. But we always end up being dominated by these institutions. You know, being ordered by these institutions, you know, what to do and how to live and things like that. So that's a conflict as long as mankind, I guess, and it will always be like that.